So this is lecture 44. We are going to discuss, not in depth, but to impart knowledge, what is what, about the flutter that occurs in the aircraft wings. Then we will discuss about general bearings, all about the surface level knowledge, or what is what, because this is not the subject where we can teach in depth of the phenomena like the journal hydrodynamic action. And we will also discuss about something called oil well and oil whip. So these two phenomena are the sources for self-excited vibrations. Then after that, if time permits, we will take up the next topic, that is the tuned mass observers. So that is the essence topic. So we will start now with the flutter. So you can see the picture given. We have seen the last class videos about the flutter occurring in aircraft wings. Okay? So unusually you have seen that well-built aircraft wings started moving at certain higher speeds. We also seen the same phenomena even in some small flexible blades. So that is to be taken care. So how that flutter occurs, it is shown here very brief. If I say the aircraft wings are made of a particular shape, that is the aerodynamic shape, it's called aerofoil. So you have set of aerofoils is already cataloged, and they are given names also. So some number, NACA number, if you say that is a particular aerofoil. You can choose aerofoil from already cataloged thing where you get the information about that. Now this is an airfoil. So you consider that is an aircraft wing that will undergo the two types of vibrations. Okay, so if I take, this is my aircraft wing, this will undergo the vibration like this. Okay, I think lighting is required. Now if I take an aircraft wing, it may undergo the vibrations in this way, that is bending. Okay, that is called flexural mode of vibration. Because of the elasticity, like a scale, if you take, the scale can bend, so that is one mode. Apart from that, there is the vibrations in the, like this, it is the torsional mode. Okay, so you have a bending like this, and the torsional modes can occur in an aircraft wing because that is long enough. Now if that two modes are in phase with each other, that means both of them are reaching the maximum and minimum at the same time, that is vibrations in phase. What is shown here is out of the full cycle, the work, what is being net work done, for example the quarter of the cycle, the lift force is acting upwards, the displacement is also upwards, so you have a net work is done on the aircraft wing. So energy is added in the first quarter of the cycle. The second quarter of the cycle, the lift force is still acting upwards, but the displacement is downwards. That means If that is a negative work, that work must be done by the aerofoil to for this motion. So work done is negative in that sense. So within this half cycle, if you take that, the net work done is zero. Net work done on the airfoil is zero. Okay, the work done by the lift forces. So now the other half of the cycle, if you take the third quarter, the lift force is downwards because the direction, what you call is that angle, okay, so that angle is looking down, so the force, lift force is downwards. Then you see that the work done is positive because the displacement and this are in the same direction, whereas the fourth quarter, the force and the displacement are the opposite direction. Okay, so what happens is, in a cycle, when the flexural mode and the twisting mode are in phase, the net work added is zero. That means the vibration cannot build up. Okay, so that is what is shown in the two modes are in phase. If you take these two are in 90 degree out of phase, that is your bending mode or flexural mode and the twisting mode, if they are 90 degree out of phase, then you see that in the first quarter lift force is up and this is also up, so net work done is positive. And the airfoil now is turned downwards, the angle of attack is in the negative direction, so lift force is downwards and the displacement is also downwards, so you have a positive work again. You can see the third quarter also you have positive work and fourth quarter also positive work. So energy is added in the cycle, net energy is added. That means every time you are going to add, every cycle energy is fed into this. So that will sustain your vibration, or it will sustain the vibration against the damping, or so that the vibration can build up to a level, or if the damping is not sufficient, it can build up to the dangerous level so that it will break. This is called a flutter. Okay, so what you have seen in the aircraft wing or the models that were kept in the wind tunnel experiment, they all shown that behavior. Further, they could, vibrations could build up and broke the entire structure. It is because of this particular phenomena. So there is something called aerodynamic flutter you have to take when you are dealing with the objects or the machineries which are interacting with the air. Okay, so this can cause any doubts. So this probably I'll send you, you can have a much better look at that. Then if you have further doubt, you can ask. But now at this stage, you know there is something called a flutter. The flutter will occur because of the out of phase of the two different vibration modes, that is, one is the twisting mode and another is the fluxing mode. Even in Tacoma Bridge, you could see that there is a twisting mode as well as fluxing mode are there. So there is, if the phase is also a particular, it happens in a particular phase, the energy will be added in every cycle, then it is not dissipated by your damping, then vibration will build up. Now the next topic is, we have said that the self-excited vibrations can occur in hydrodynamic bearings as well. There is a bearing called journal bearing. Okay, so you most probably would have seen a bearing. Most of the time we say a bearing means it's a bearing, a ball bearing. Ball bearing for us is easy to see. So there is another type of bearing called journal bearing, where you have a shaft and a bush in between, the oil is there. Okay. Now what happens is, yeah, in the journal bearing, that is, first one is, it is at rest. The shaft is not rotating. So you have a shaft and there is an oil film, mostly because of the weight of the your shaft and the associated components attached to the shaft. The bearing will squeeze the oil out, then that will be in contact. These two will be in contact. That is at rest. When you start the journal bearing, it is no longer at rest. It starts. When this starts, the oil is propelled. It is having a viscosity, so it propels. Then it uniquely, after a certain time, after certain few rotations, the shaft will not be at the center but slightly away, so that it will form what is called as an wedge here. So that will be responsible for circulating the oil around. And when it circulates in that process, you have a very small, a thin film, and you have a high pressure is also built up. The pressure in the oil film around is not uniform. So pressure is higher in this area, so that holds your load. Okay. Earlier the oil, when it is static, it is not able to hold you the load. So there was a physical contact between the shaft and the journal. Journal and the bush, whereas here when it starts rotating, that hydrodynamic phenomena, what is called, will make the slightly offset. There will be something, the pumping action that builds the pressure. Okay, so that creates the oil to flow around. That normally oil speed will be, in general, it will be half of the surface speed of your shaft. The shaft is surface speed of the shaft. It is not RPM. You can calculate what is the surface speed, half of that. This hydrodynamic lubrication, this is in equilibrium, no problem, it will continue to work. Okay. So one of the important feature of the journal bearing is that, you know, that since there is an oil film, only during starting you have the contact between the two metal parts. Whereas when it is in operation, in this equilibrium condition, there won't be any metal to metal contact at all. So it will continue to, you know, have a very, very long service life, because there is no contact, no wear and tear. So it will have a very, very long service life. You know that by default, many, many high bearing loaded machineries, even your crankshaft, what type of bearing we use in the crankshaft, very small engines only use ball bearings, but otherwise it's only journal bearings. Okay, so journal bearing is used. And if you take turbines, steam turbines or gas turbines or jet engines of your aircraft, everything, you have a shaft and a bearing. Default, by default you can say all these bearings are journal bearings only. Okay, so sometimes what they do is to the journal bearing, it loses life whenever when it is a metal to metal contact, that is during the starting or in stopping, it will come into contact. So during the starting and stopping also, if you don't want to have a contact, you don't put a simple oil, you pressurize it and circulate it so that there is no contact at all. Okay, so that is the functioning of a journal bearing. But what happens is, it is a normal equilibrium position. But if sudden change in the speed or some other abnormality occurs, that will slightly squeeze. If this shaft is slightly, that is the equilibrium position. If that particular equilibrium position is disturbed, that will create some kind of instability. So that we call it as the oil whirl. The shaft will be rotating like this inside the, no longer the shaft is stationary and rotate, the axis of the shaft or the center of the shaft, if you say, the center of the shaft there is static. In equilibrium condition it stays, it is not aligning with the center of the bush, there is some eccentricity, but that will be staying as it is. But when a sudden load or external disturbances comes, so there is a force acting like this, so that will make the center of the shaft to move like this, that is called oil whirl. So that introduces, you know, a changing force. This is approximately that particular thing will be about half of the rotating speed. That is what we call a subharmonic. So this is what it happens. After this center, if you take, that will follow an elliptical path. Okay. So this is also a source of the self-excited vibrations. Because it is the journal bearings are used in a very critical equipment, this is also should be taken care. Now I'll try to play an interesting video. This video is from a blog, but I found it interesting. This blog has number of videos you can see. So this person also explains it very nicely. Now you can hear that.
It's not the same size all the way around there. This would be important when we turn the machine on. But before we do that, in order to understand what happens during operation, we should talk about the third component of our dynamic bearing, the lubricant. Any fluid, including the viscous axis, is made up of many tiny little molecules held together by intermolecular forces of attraction. When a fluid flows, layers of these molecules slide past one another, attracting and pulling on each other. And this causes the resistance to flow. It's like the fluid's internal friction. Most people just think of it as how thick the fluid is, but the technical term for this characteristic is viscosity. Molasses, as well as being extremely delicious, also has a relatively high viscosity. Kerosene, on the other hand, as well as being not delicious at all, has weaker intermolecular forces of attraction, and therefore has a relatively low viscosity. But temperature also plays a role in a fluid's viscosity in any given application. When it comes to liquids, an increase in temperature results in a decrease in viscosity, and vice versa. That's where the phrase slow as molasses in January comes from. The reason why we care about viscosity in a hydrodynamic bearing is because the same forces which attract fluids to themselves also make them sticky. They're attracted to the surfaces of objects, like a shell and gerbil in a bearing. When the machine is turned on, the gerbil begins to rotate. It drags the lubricant around the bearing and jams the lubricant between the two sliding surfaces at the point where they contact. The gerbil is essentially pumping the lubricant. The pressure underneath the gerbil begins to rise, and when the gerbil is swimming fast enough, a lubricant wedge forms, which lifts the gerbil off the sleeve and completely separates the two surfaces. This is where lubricant viscosity plays a crucial role. Too low of the viscosity, and the wedge won't form at all. But too high of the viscosity, and friction will quickly overheat the bearing. Incidentally, the lubricant wedge also pushes the gerbil off to one side of the sleeve. This condition is known as full film lubrication. It's like hydroplaning in your car when you drive over a puddle and momentarily lose steering control because the tires are sliding on a film of water. Loads imposed on the bearing are supported in the load zone, and the relatively wide area of the load zone explains why hydrodynamic bearings have such a high radial load carrying capacity. The thickness of the film may only be a thousandth of an inch, but if the bearing was designed for the correct clearance, shaft speed, and lubricant viscosity, and it's been maintained properly, then there should technically be no physical contact between the two sliding surfaces, and therefore there should be no wear of the gerbil or the sleeve. Theoretically, a hydrodynamic bearing should be able to run forever without ever needing to be repaired or replaced. In fact, there are some which have been in service for over 100 years. There are a few variations on the plain hydrodynamic bearing that we've outlined here. For example, since the shaft needs to get up to speed for full film lubrication to form, the bearing is especially vulnerable to wear, both start up and shut down. So, the bearings in some very large, very heavy machines have auxiliary hydraulic pumps which actually pressurize the lubricant through oil slots in the bottom of the bearing. This helps to lift the gerbil off the sleeve. Sometimes these designs are referred to as hydrostatic rather than hydrodynamic. Some bearings are designed with tilting pads evenly spaced around the inside of the bearing. The pads can pivot slightly, and each one forms its own hydrodynamic wedge. This helps to stabilize the shaft. Now, normally hydrodynamic bearings can only handle radial loads and are free to float axially. But when the tilting pad design is applied to the face of the bearing and made into a collar on the shaft, then axial or thrust loads can also be supported, very effectively, I might add. And of course, oil and grease are not the only fluids used in hydrodynamic bearings. The high-speed spindles and the hard drive from your computer actually run on air bearings and very fine surface tensions. Well, that's your introduction to hydrodynamic bearings. Their construction, the basic operation, and a few of the
So you have seen that video. I think he has a number of videos explaining various aspects of mechanical engineering. That will be quite useful. Now I have to take up the tuned mass absorber, but it requires more time to derive it. So instead I will play the video showing the tuned mass absorbers in action. Okay? Somebody moves on the bridge or jumps on the bridge, you see that how severely this shakes. We already seen in resonance such a bridge where lot of vibration people can create if they move in a particular pattern. Now you see how they tackle this. Same bridge, some magic has been done. You can see what happens. Jump in whatever way, the bridge is not responding as it used to be. Now what is the magic it's done? The solution is this stuff which is added at the bottom of the bridge. So that is what we call it as a tuned mass absorber. It's nothing but a spring mass damper system which is added to this. But you have to engineer it properly so that you take a right amount of mass and right amount of damping and right amount of stiffness so that you attach it a particular place so that the vibrations whatever is created is entirely passed on to this, not to the parent or the one which we are interested, that is the bridge. Okay? Now it's not only for the bridge, for high-rise buildings too, this is the only way to solve the problem of vibration. So you can see a model is built, one with the tuned mass absorber and the other one without. So when a vibration is given, you can see that how it responds. what is that he has done? He has locked that tuned mass absorber so that both of them vibrated. Now he releases the tuned mass absorber. Okay. The one without that is still vibrating, the other one has come to a stop much earlier. We'll see that. Even though the audio is absent, that he didn't explain that he locked the tuned mass observer. It is clear that he has locked the tuned mass observer so that it is not in action. But now he released that. Now you see what happens. So what vibrates is your tuned mass absorber vibrates and makes your the original structure stable. Now next I will show you another video about the tuned mass absorber only. But that is interesting. Oh, it's not very good. So this is what they showed. With observer. So you can see there is a pendulum sort of thing is added. And the vibrations have come down substantially. Now this is what I told you. But this is a very interesting thing. Using any sophisticated equipment, he builds that model and uses an accelerometer which are available for 200-300 rupees. You use interface with the Arduino board, another 300 rupees. You are now having an equipment to measure the oscillations. Okay, so he is a very enterprising. Skyscrapers like Burj Khalifa or Taipei 101. Taipei 101, you can see that's a huge pendulum. Okay?
Wind can induce oscillation in a building, just like a tidal strap on a vehicle. A strong earthquake can also excite the building's resonant frequency, just like plucking a guitar string. in most cases, the movement's not enough to correct the safety of the building itself. But that non-movement can be profoundly uncomfortable to its occupants. Most of us hold an intrinsic belief that buildings should not move. We don't even think about it. For our entire lives, Wednesday is coming after Thursday, the sun is risen at the east, and our domiciles and dwellings have remained static beneath our feet. So you can forgive your subconscious for feeling some amount of terror when such a fundamental belief is shaken, especially when the shaking is literal. It may not be enough to harm the building's structure, but it's certainly enough to cause a 1% on the top floor to lose its caveat. And buildings aren't good for much if people don't want to be inside them. So engineers have come up with some novel solutions for minimizing this unwelcome vacillation. And I want to talk about one of those today, the tuned mass damper, or TMD. A TMD reduces the amplitude of vibration by absorbing the kinetic energy from the system, in this case, the swaying motion of a tall building. For a long time, TMDs were relegated to areas where the rest of the building's mechanical equipment in front of the view. That changed in 2004 when the Taipei 101 tower finished construction in Taiwan. Rather than hide the world's largest sphere.
So earlier he said that this tuned mass absorber is supposed to be an ugly stuff to be provided. They will conceal it in skyscrapers. In Taipei 101, what they did is they wanted to make it as a showpiece. So they built a big pendulum which is hanging around, everybody can see. That become a showpiece.
Well, to understand, the building's designers should show some open to the public. Taipei 101's TMD is a common draw for tourists, and even has its own mascot, the Amphibian, which looks like it came straight off the island of misfit mascots. Anyway, the publicity associated with the Taipei 101 has sort of unveiled this really cool bit of engineering, that is the tuned mass damper. And you can find tons of videos of it in action online. So how does it work? I constructed this model of a pendulum-style tuned mass damper in a skyscraper. I can pull the car back and give it to the pump, which excites its resonant frequency, just like an earthquake or a strong wind event. The benefit here is that I can do it in a somewhat repeatable fashion so we can evaluate the effectiveness of the damper. For the TMD, the damper comes from the tension of the screw, which is acting as an hinge. I can tighten the screw in.
So he uses a pendulum type absorber, and the damping comes from the friction. So by tightening the screw, he can increase the damper. Okay? So very
increase the damper. The tuning comes from moving this mass up or down in the middle of the shaft. This changes the frequency of the pendulum just like a metronome, which can be tuned to the resonant frequency of the building. Add an accelerometer on top of the building so we can measure its movement.
So he fixes an accelerometer, I told you it cost just 120 rupees, nothing more, three axes, connected to Arduino board, connected to your computer, you will get a nice output.
And this is hooked to an Arduino, which is sending the data to my laptop. There's more in the description below if you're curious about the data collection. If I lock the pendulum and set the building swaying, we can get a sense of how it would perform with only the building's known natural damping. Applying the acceleration response, we can see that the model experienced a maximum amplitude of about 4 meters per square second, or half a G, with a period of 0.6 seconds. Frequency is the inverse of period, so we can get the building's fundamental frequency, 1.7 hertz. We can also see that the building has some natural damping just due to the amount of friction in its movement. Otherwise, it would just sway indefinitely. We can estimate the model's natural damping ratio using the luxury of the projector. I get a damping ratio of 0.01. The damping ratio, denoted by one of the tougher Greek letters to draw, zeta, is a measure of how quickly the amplitude decays in an oscillating system. Systems with a damping ratio greater than 1 are said to be overdamped because the system returns to equilibrium without oscillating. Systems with a damping ratio less than 1 are said to be underdamped since they experience some oscillation. If the damping ratio is exactly 1, the system is critically damped and returns to equilibrium as quickly as possible. And if the system is undamped, the oscillation continues indefinitely. There are less than undamped situations, but we won't get into them in this paper. Now that we know the approximate natural its length. For a frequency of around 1.7 hertz, the pendulum needs to be approximately 3.5 inches long. Now let's try the exact same experiment with the pendulum able to swing freely. The kinetic energy of the building does get transferred to the pendulum at first, but because there's no damping, the pendulum transfers the energy right back into the building. So instead of reducing the amplitude, instead the pendulum just continuously swaps the kinetic energy of the building by the oscillation. You can only imagine that this erratic behavior would be even more alarming to our topmost tenants than the steady but slowly decaying motion of the previous example. Now, let's tighten the screw to add some damping to the pendulum and see what happens. Even without looking at the data, you can see a remarkable difference in performance. Looking at the plot of acceleration response, we can see that the peak acceleration was about 3.5 meters per second, so a reduction of only about 12%. But the big difference is how quickly the motion decays. At the beginning, when the pendulum was swinging, I calculated the damping ratio of over 0.6. That's about 6 times more damping without TMD. Once the pendulum stops swinging, the rest of the swing follows the approximate natural damping ratio of the building itself, as expected. But the majority of the kinetic energy has already been dissipated by the damping, so the amplitude is much lower. Here's a slow speed side by side so you can really compare it.
Mass damper is also is in the form of what is called a stock bridge. Is also in the form of something called a stock bridge damper. So that is used for suppressing the cable vibrations. So this is a suspension bridge. What he is trying to show is there are stock bridge dampers attached to each cable. Now he arrests that with that wire tab that is popularly used in Saravana stores for tagging your, you know, bags. So that wire wraps are there and now it is locked. Now you can see the oscillations are higher. Now the this is in not in action. Now he releases the stock bridge. Now the oscillations or vibrations are substantially less. So that's all for today. Next class we will see the theory of it.